Okay, great. Thank you for the invitation. It's a great workshop and I learned a lot today in the morning, so it's super cool to be here. What I'll talk today about, it will be kind of complementary to what we learned in the morning. And I really want to give you a set of use cases and how do you take this graph convolutional network type machinery and really scale it and apply it to real world problems. So I'll talk about what we've been doing in our group, and some of it is published and some of it isn't published. Applications will come from kind of computational biology drug discovery, which we are doing with Chan Zuckerberg Biohub, and then there will be applications from Pinterest that's used by hundreds of millions of people. Why do I like networks? The reason why I like networks is because they allow me to develop methods that can be applied to many different domains, right? So I see networks as a very nice and very natural representation or a data model for data coming from different domains. And we have seen this throughout all the talks, kind of emphasizing that it doesn't really matter what kind of network you are looking at. At the end, you have the same underlying representation. And I'll be worrying about graphs, and these graphs can be of actors, people, proteins, you name it, right? And then once you have the graphs, one of the kind of fundamental problems on graphs is to do what is called node classification or semi-supervised node classification, where the idea is that I give you a graph, I give you examples of nodes having a few different colors, and then I ask you, can you label the other nodes for me, the ones, the gray ones with a question mark, right? And if you do, it would be great if your learning algorithm would go and label the remaining unknown nodes, right? And the fundamental problem you have when you are trying to do that is to come up with some kind of featureized way to describe what is the position of these unknown nodes in the network, so you can start making predictions, or you have to make some kind of smoothness assumptions in the graph and then try to learn how to classify, right? And especially I think when working in networks, we are troubled by this kind of step where, you know, we are given the data, the network, and then the question is how do you come up with descriptions of nodes? How do you come up with feature representations for these nodes so you can start applying some machine learning down the line? And usually the kind of the most tedious task is come up with these feature representations or features for nodes, especially the structural ones. So what I'd like to do in this talk is basically take these networks and map the nodes to some small dimensional space so that then I can apply all kinds of machine learning methods that know how to work with vector data to this. And I'll be talking about how do you get, what kind of network representations can you build, and how then you do this kind of embedding of the nodes in some d-dimensional space where you can think of d as an order of 1,000. And in particular, I'll be talking about a set of approaches that we call graph sage that is all about kind of how do you sample and aggregate across the graph structure. And you could think of this as a variant of graph convolutional networks that we learned a lot about in the morning before lunch today. Okay? So that's the idea. And the intuition how these things will work kind of can be borrowed from the success of convolutional neural networks in computer vision, right? Where the way you can think of it is that you take a small patch of the image and somehow transform and aggregate it into some new representation for that patch, and you can do this across patches and through many, many layers and so on. And the way you can think of it is that basically you can say that if you are in this 3x3 patch, you take the information from the nearby pixels in the patch, collect them, transform them, and aggregate them. And this sounds great because in grids, right, as we saw in the morning, you can have this operator and you're kind of sliding it through the image. But the problem becomes that real graphs are much more complex and don't have this kind of nice regular structure that would lend itself nicely to this kind of sliding windows. So how could you apply kind of deep learning to graphs, right? One way how you could consider doing this is to say, let me take my adjacency matrix that describes the connections between the nodes of the graph, right? Zero means that a particular pair of nodes is not connected, and one means it is connected. And maybe you could concatenate that with the feature description for every node. Maybe that is, you know, the age of the person and things like that. And then you could take this and fit it kind of line by line into a deep neural network to make some prediction about this graph. And people have tried this, but it's kind of a terrible idea. First is that the number of parameters you have in this network is basically on the order of the nodes in the network. The other problem is that if you train this on a 5x5 graph, if I give you a 6-node graph, you don't know what to do with that, right? It's for fixed size graphs only. And then the other problem that these approaches have is that if I renumber the nodes, if I label the nodes instead of, you know, A, B, C, D in that way, but in a different way, the matrix will change, and then this network has to learn how to be invariant to the way you label or number the nodes. So that's one way how you could do this, and this would be a very naive approach. A second approach would be that if you still have this idea that you want to have some kind of sliding window over the graph, maybe the idea is to say, oh, I want to define a sliding window centered at this particular node. Think of my example from convolutions. What you could do is to say, okay, let me take the neighbors in the network that are adjacent to my red node of interest. And now what do I have to do? I have to somehow decide how many neighbors I will take, in what order I will put them, so that then I could throw them into some neural architecture and pass that information through, right? And what are the problems you have here? The problems is that you basically are limited to a fixed neighborhood size, and you are limited to how are you going again to number and canonicalize these different neighborhoods so that you can feed them through the same architecture. So these are some of the things that don't necessarily that have kind of lots of practical problems. So what are some of the challenges when working with this type of data? So one is that in graphs is the node ordering, right? Two graphs are equivalent, they are isomorphic, but you can number the nodes in a different way or in a different order. And we'd like our model to kind of account for this and not give you a different result if you renumber the nodes or you enumerate the nodes in a different order, right? And this kind of relates to the solving the graph isomorphism problem. The other thing is, right, that when we do these things, we'd like them kind of similar to convolutional operators on the image. We'd like them to be kind of local in the graph, whatever that means. The other thing that we'd like to do is to have the number of parameters to be fixed or to be independent of the graph size. Right, so the graph can be bigger and bigger, but the number of parameters should be independent of that. And then what I'd like to be able to do is I'd like to be able to apply this across different graphs, having different structures, and I'd also be able to do almost like transfer learning, right? I'd like to train on one graph and then transport the model to another graph, right? These are things I'd like to have, and I'll show you examples why these things are important. And when people started doing feature learning on graphs, the earliest approaches like the deep walk, node2vec, and so on, basically what they are doing is they are trying to linearize a graph, right? So what they do is they would run a particular random walk across the nodes of the graph so that you say, I start here and I do a random walk. So basically you almost like generate a sentence so that then you can apply, in a sense, word2vec with a sliding window over that sentence you generated starting at a given node. And the kind of in this way, you linearize the graph so that then you can apply word2vec type approaches. What's the problem with that is that generating random walks is expensive and that the number of parameters is linear is basically equals the number of nodes you have in the graph, because for every node you want to learn an embedding, right? And maybe when you do representation learning for text, that's not too bad because the number of words is relatively limited, but in graphs, for every node you want to have its own embedding, so you have a set of parameters associated with that node. So this is kind of what the state of the landscape is. So what I will talk about here is the idea, how can we take graph convolutional networks and kind of adapt them to this inductive node embedding setting where graphs can change, nodes can come and go, you can transfer across graphs, but you'd still be, you'd like to compute. I'll show you examples how you can kind of generalize beyond simple convolutions, and then I'll give you examples of how this works. And you can apply it to heterogeneous networks, simple networks, graphs with billions of edges, and things like that. And the idea for this comes from the following, right? The idea is that the graph The social network, if you think of it, the network, will define the computation graph. Right? So the idea is, if I want to compute something for this node, maybe I want to compute the embedding for it, or a label for it, what I will do is I will look at the neighborhood, the network neighborhood around this node. And the structure of this network neighborhood will define the structure of the underlying neural network. You can think of it that way, right? And then what I will really do is to say, let every node here in this network have some feature vector associated with it. And what I will learn is how to propagate this information captured by the feature vectors, how to transform it, aggregate it, and kind of pass it towards my target node I. Right? So basically, in some sense, I will learn how to propagate information across the graph, where the propagation structure is defined by the nodes and edges of that network. Right? And what I will then do is I'll be able to learn the transformations and the aggregation functions that do the magic. Right? So the way to think about this, if I have a simple graph and I'm interested in producing an embedding for this particular label for this particular node A, then here is how the neural network architecture would look like. And this projector is not very good. So how this looks like is the following. You say, here's my node A. This node A has three neighbors. So here are the three neighbors of it. What I will do is I will pass the information from these neighbors, I'll transform it, and then here I will aggregate it and output it to node A, right? And now you say, how do the nodes B, C, and D get the information? They also gather it from their own neighbors, right? And you can see that, for example, node B has two nodes here because it has two neighbors, right? And that's one way how I can think of this, right? Is that for every node, I'll basically have a different propagation or compute graph where I will initialize my feature vectors to be whatever are the feature vectors properties of the nodes, but then I'll transform and propagate those across the neighborhood of the network, right? And that's the way to think about this. And how could you write it differently? Here is maybe one way how you could write this out, right? You would say, I will have this, let this be the feature representation for a given node, where the superscript is at what level of propagation I am. And I will initialize the h of a given node at the kth level, at the kth layer, to be simply the attributes of a given node in the graph. And then what this is basically saying, it says, the feature representation for a given node at the next layer is its previous layer feature representation transformed plus some kind of general aggregation function over the neighbors of that node, their feature representations at the current layer transformed through the nonlinearity and then kind of concatenating both, transforming it again, and that gives me kind of the feature representation for a node at the next level, right? That's one way to look at this. So in some sense, all I'm doing is I'm propagating the information from the neighbors, transforming it, and then aggregating it with my current information if I'm node A, so that I get my feature representation at the next level. So that's one way how you can look at this. Another way how you can look at this is if you write it in terms of for loops, where you say these are in some sense the how far in the network I'm going to propagate information. So this you can think of it as the depth of my network. I will initialize representations for everyone at level zero to be simply their feature vectors, their vectors of attributes, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over these different surge depths where at every stage I do two operations. One is that I go over given nodes neighbors, I aggregate their feature representations from the previous levels to come up with the aggregated representation for the neighborhood. I concatenate that with the current node feature representation, transform it again, pass through nonlinearity, and I get the feature representation for that node at the next level, right? And then I can go kind of to the, I do this over all the nodes, I can normalize the representations, and then I do one more iteration of K, where now I would kind of collect at the second at the second step, right? So I have this notion of aggregation, and I have this notion of kind of concatenating node with current feature information with the aggregated features from the neighbors, and my final feature representation for a given node will simply be the features at the final layer, capital K. And the point is that I can now have this, and I can write down the loss function, and I can go and train or optimize this model. There is a very nice connection to the Weiss-Fire-Lehmann graph isomorphism test, where basically the pseudocode I showed you on the previous slide is the same. The only thing that you would change is rather than in this isomorphism test algorithm, rather than having aggregation function here, you would basically have hash functions. And the idea is that basically you have each node represented as a bit vector, and then you are aggregating these bit vectors over the graph to come up with a signature for a given node. And then the idea is that if two graphs are isomorphic, nodes will have similar signatures. So in some sense, this is similar to that, just that the operations are different. So now the question is, how do I train this thing? And basically the way, the basic idea is, let's do parameter sharing, right? So the idea is that for every, to compute the embedding, the feature vector or a label for every node has a different network neighborhood, so they will have a different computation graph. But what is shared are these parameters, these matrices W and Q, right? Q is the transformation matrix, and W is then the matrix that takes the, that after concatenation, you again transform and pass through a nonlinearity. So in this case, you would have kind of four parameter matrices, W, two for the, let's say if we count this way, the second level of the network, and then W and Q, one for the first level of the network, right? And these W's here are shared, and the same way W's and Q's across here are all shared, right? So, and this now gives you a way to basically train these parameters, right? And you are free to choose whatever loss you would like. You can come up with some kind of unsupervised type of losses that have been used to do this. You can also do, for example, neighborhood sampling. If these networks become too big, there are clever ways how you can kind of make them smaller and subsample the neighborhood of a node. This is important in networks that have heavy tail degree distributions and you have nodes with huge degrees. You can do various kinds of mini batch optimization at the training and so on. And you could come up with different kind of notions of generalization, generalizing the kind of how do you aggregate the neighborhood. You have a question? Yes. So I think the difference is the following. We are more careful how we do the aggregation. We give you more freedom. How do you do this transformation operation? So in some sense, it is a generalization of what they did. And then what we also do is, I won't go into that, is we are careful how you construct these graphs because we really want to make this scale. That's a great point. Okay. So why is this a good idea? It's a good idea because you can use any kind of aggregation function you like. You could do you could even have an LSTM inside there. You can do max pooling, whatever you like. As I said, you can use different loss functions. What is nice is the model has constant number of parameters, right? Regardless of how this network looks like, you are basically having a set of parameters for every level. And usually we train this for two levels, so you would have a fixed number of parameters regardless of how big is the graph. What is also nice is that once you trained these parameters, you can transfer them to a new network and run the propagation there to come up with embeddings. If the network is evolving and new nodes join, all you have to do is compute, is basically figure out how their network neighborhood looks like and then propagate to the information to update their embedding. So in some sense, you can apply this to any node in any network. And just to give you an now I want to kind of go to the application mode and show you some examples how this works. So here I'll show you examples on three different data sets. The first two are basically semi-supervised node classification type tasks, where you have networks of a few hundred thousand nodes, and you want to label nodes in the citation graph based on the subject category of the paper. And in Reddit, we were asking classifying posts into what community, what subreddits they come from. And then the last one is interesting. It's a protein-protein interaction network where you are doing protein function prediction. So you are labeling the nodes in the proteins. But the idea here is that you have a different protein interaction network for every tissue in your body. And functions of proteins differ between tissues. So the idea is that you will train on 20 tissues, and then you know maybe you train on lung, brain, and so on. And then I give you a heart protein interaction network, and I say, label me this network from scratch, right? So you're doing kind of transfer learning. Here is how well these things are doing on these toy data sets. We are getting around 40% average improvement. Here I'm doing this as a micro F1 score over a six-way classification problem, 50-way classification problem, and here is, I think, a 1,000-way classification problem. But these are relatively small-scale things. What I want to show you now is that this really scales to real problems. So where we tried to apply this is at Pinterest. And what is Pinterest? It's not a social network, but it's a place where people organize images into collections, right? So the idea is that you can take an image, a pin, basically a visual bookmark, and organize it into a collection, right? So I can say, I can create a collection of cool jackets, and then I can save that into my board, my collection of cool jackets, right? And you can take that and say, things I wanna wear in the winter in LA, and you save it into your collection, right? And this graph, basically what this allows people to do is to find ideas of what are the cool objects and what collections they belong to, okay? So this is the input data. So what we wanna do in this case, we wanna do some kind of semi-supervised node embedding for graph-based recommendations. So the idea is the following. I will take this Pinterest graph, and I will clean it quite a bit so that it's smaller than it really is, but it will still have 2 billion of these images, pins, 1 billion boards, which are the collections, and about 20 billion edges. And every edge basically tells me that a given pin belongs to a given board, right? So if I have this strawberry smoothie with chocolate, somebody will put it, you know, into strawberry smoothies board. Somebody else will save it into the, I guess, healthy food type of things. Somebody else will save it in, I don't know, things I wanna eat during summer, right? This is the graph. What is important for this graph is that it has two properties. One is that it's extremely dynamic because people are saving these pins as they are using Pinterest. New pins are being added every day, and new boards, new collections are being added every day by users. And what is nice is that each of these pins has lots of features, right? There is the image that's associated with it, there is a description, and so on and so forth, right? And what we would like to do is, we would like to apply this to related pin recommendations. So this kind of item-based recommendations, where the idea will be, if I give you a pin, tell me what other pins are related to it, right? So I wanna do what is called a related pin recommendation, right? I want to exploit the graph structure because things that are related, they belong to similar boards, right? And I also want to exploit image information, the feature information, because things that are related hopefully look alike, right? That's the idea. So the way we do this is that we are saying the following. We are saying, let's say that the user is looking at a given pin, what other pin X are they going to interact with or save next? And that's our signal for relatedness. To show you that this is actually a hard task, let's say this is a query. It's a picture of a thank you card. After a user was seeing this thing, then the next thing they interacted with is this particular "you are special to me, thank you" type card, right? So these two cards are definitely related, right? So this would be a positive example. For this query pin, we wanna output this particular answer. This is a random negative example, right? It's a cottage in the woods. It's an easy negative example. But the way we train things is that we also come up with this kind of hard negative examples. So this looks similar, but it's not related because it's a happy birthday card. It's not a thank you card, okay? So now that we have these positive and negative training examples, and we have two kinds of negative training examples, yes? This is constructed is the following. Great question. This is based on user interaction, right? I use some signal on the website to say, oh, this is a positive example. Let's say people saving this thing into their board, and then 10 minutes later saving this to the same board. Then I say, this must have something in common. That's how I do this. Picking random pins is easy. How do I come up with these hard negative examples is, we have a random walk-based recommender system that only operates on this bipartite graph, and we run that to kind of diffuse the information through the graph, and then we take things that are at rank 5,000, 10,000, and we call those hard negative examples. Okay, so this is heuristic. That's the best way to say it. Okay, so what do we do? We take around 300 million nodes, pins. And about 1 billion edges, and we have about 1.2 billion training pairs, where basically we have a query pin, related pin, a hard negative example, and an easy negative example. And then basically you can think I have basically 1.2 billion small neural networks like this that share all these parameters. And then what we do is we batch them into around 2,000 networks per batch and optimize the parameters and kind of going from batch to batch. Okay? So this is how we learn the parameters of the model, where the attributes, the features at the bottom are basically image features that I think come from VGG16 or something. Okay? So that's how we train this thing. How do you do inference right now? I have trained the layers of this network. Now I need to do inference on this 20 billion node graph. The way we do that is actually that the inference lends itself nicely to a MapReduce type job, right? Do people know MapReduce? Yes? Okay, great. So why does this lend itself to MapReduce? Is because you can take your feature vectors, you join them, you send them through the multilayer perceptron to do the transformation, and then now that you have transformed them, you basically bring the graph information to know so that you say, aha, this is the source set of features, but I need now to transfer to the destination node, right? So you would here bring in the destination node information, you would then group by the destination node so that then you can reduce, meaning that you can now aggregate the information, and this is how you propagated the information one step through the network. And now whatever is here, you can basically do another pass of MapReduce, and now you propagated it for two steps. And we can do this on this entire network. And what is nice is that it avoids repeated computation, because here this basically you did the compute, and then the group by key, basically the sort, the shuffle in MapReduce, allows you to propagate the information across the graph. Okay? Show you briefly experiments. We are doing, again, related pin recommendation. I'll show you comparison against something where we are doing nearest neighbor using visual similarity. Another thing where we are doing nearest neighbor with a kind of textual similarity of the description of pins through the word to web. I'll show we did also play by basically combining this through another, like I think it was like a three-layer network, and then think of this as embeddings. I'll show you an example of a random walk algorithm, which is basically just operating on this graph, and this is what this was the state. This was the current recommender engine that we were using, and then this learned convolutional neural network type setup. And then what's the task? The task is I give you the query pin, and then you want to rank all the other 2 billion pins and find the ones that are kind of closest in terms of the embedding, right? So it's a ranking task of 2 billion objects. How are we going to measure performance? We'll do two. One is, in some sense, we call it hit rate. It's basically what's the recall at top k. I think here we are using k equals 100. So basically I'm asking what fraction of times was this ground truth related pin ranked among the 100 closest pins. For visual and text based, that's around, let's say, 17, 14%. If you combine them, you are at 27. This is the vanilla version of our algorithm is at 46. I think we were now able to push it to around 60. And this is the mean reciprocal rank matrix. Where these things work really well is when you have information that's kind of complementary, right? You have the graph plus visual. So if I ask, if this is my query pin and I say what's related, if I match it based on visual information, then basically it's confusing the soil for ground meat, so we have kind of bimimbaps and things like that. If you do the random walk, then the random walk, because of the graph information, because the graph captures how things are related, it kind of figures out that these are plants, and you know it gives you some plants, but it's kind of not really related. And then our approach would give you, basically would give you a good balance between the two, so it would find things that are visually similar, but also close in the graph. Yes? Number of negatives is 1,999,000,999. Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, no, it's good. So I'm saying I have one positive example, you rank 2 billion, and you ask, what's the positive example at top, among top 100? That's, and this is the fraction of times it was. And then the what we define as hit rate. Yes? Sorry?
Do you have comparison to GCN?
I won't because it would take me, yeah, I don't because I can't, right? It's a 20 billion node edge graph, right? So the original thing, just no way. Mm-hmm. Good, okay? So what did I show you is this idea of how do you sample and aggregate information across graphs, how it allows me to both fuse the node attribute information and the graph information. What is nice is that the model size is independent of the graph size, and we can do this on 20 billion edges, which I think is maybe 4 or 5 orders more than what I've seen in other papers in terms of size, and it leads to good results. What is nice is that these types of things can be extended into other things as well. So I want to kind of change gears and show you some other examples how this technology can be used. And the examples here will be from computational biology drug discovery. Okay, so we'll completely shift gears, forget about social media, let's kind of try to help biology people cure disease. Okay? Two examples. One is, can you predict side effects of drug combinations, right? So the idea is, and then the second one will be, can you predict what drugs treat what diseases? So this is basically drug repurposing, and this is the idea, will you get sick if you take two drugs simultaneously, right? The way they usually do medical trials is they say there are patients, they would take a drug, and then they would see what side effects they have. But they don't go and test what happens if you take two drugs simultaneously, just because there is too many pairs to test, so it kind of side effects happen when somebody happens to be on those two drugs simultaneously. And then there is a big effort where people report back this kind of drug interaction side effects. This is very important because they call this, when you are using multiple drugs, they call this polypharmacy, and it's important for treating complex diseases. But right as you are kind of using multiple drugs on the same patients, that it leads to increased risk because of the interactions that can happen and side effects between the drugs. And right now about 15% of US population is on multiple drugs at once. And the costs of this are in kind of 170 billion. And of course, it's very hard to identify these side effects manually because they are rare. And they are not observed in clinical testing because you are not testing against all other drugs to see what happens. So how are we now going to use the technology I developed or I talked about to do this? And the idea will be that we will be basically creating these types of heterogeneous multi-level graphs of different types of nodes and different types of relationships. So here, I'll create a graph with two types of nodes. We'll have the drug nodes, and we'll have the protein nodes. And the idea is that basically the protein interaction network, basically protein interaction network is a network where you have proteins, 20,000, and the two proteins are kind of connected if they physically come together in the cell to do something together, right? So the protein networks are measured experimentally. They are amazingly noisy, and they're kind of, they're amazingly noisy, and biologists don't like to use them because they are so noisy. So anything we can do with this will be amazing by itself because the data is so low quality. On the other hand, the protein network is useful because it basically describes the wiring diagram of the cell. It tells you how life happens as things come together to do stuff together, right? So what we will do now is we'll create a network. I'll show you an example on the next slide. And we will feed the model to predict known associations between drug pairs and side effects. And then the way we'll use this is to say, here is a pair of drugs. Can you predict what kind of side effects do they have? And the way we'll model this prediction is we'll model it as an edge prediction. And because we have different side effects, we'll have different types of edges. So we'll be doing this as an edge prediction where you can predict 1,000 different edges, one for each side effect. This is the data we use for the protein-protein interaction network. Then another data set that tells you how drugs target proteins, and then the drug-drug side effects. Right. So the way you can kind of write this out as a network is the following. The idea is that this is the underlying protein-protein interaction network. Every node is a protein. Every drug is a node itself. Drug targets different proteins, so drugs and proteins are linked, and then we will also link drugs based on the side effects. And because there are different side effects, every edge will be labeled with a different side effect type. So this could be vomiting, this could be headache, and things like that. And of course, nodes in both proteins as well as drugs have some attribute feature information. Yes, I only consider interactions between pair of drugs. And one thing that is important, I only consider to predict edges that are side effects that happen due to the combination of drugs, right? So only side effects that you can attribute to the drugs working together, so that are not caused by each individual drug by itself, okay? The task, what's the link prediction task is, basically I want to do the labeled edge prediction between pairs of drugs, right? So the idea is, given a pair of drug, predict whether an edge of a given type exists there, where the type is the label, the type of the side effect, right? So it's not enough just to say, yes, there is a side effect. We'd like to predict what is the type of the side effect. And there's, I think, around 950, so basically 1,000 different side effects, right? So it's a multi-relational link prediction in this graph. So how do we now take this idea of that I showed you before and apply it here? So now your information propagation or compute architectures will be different, right? So imagine I want to compute the embedding, the feature representation for this node C. Then I have three different ways how I can aggregate information. I can aggregate information from the proteins that this drug targets. And then I can also aggregate this information along different relationship types to the nearby drugs with which this drug interacts, right? And usually we will do two steps of this, so the same graph, you can now expand it here, here, and so on, right? And of course, the graph here gets expanded because things go up, right? So that's kind of the encoder part. that tells me how to aggregate information. And then, of course, when I train this, I push back the gradients and I do this in a end-to-end in an end-to-end way. I would train it. Right. So this is on the training side. How about on the decoder side? Now that I have drugs for which I computed these embeddings, basically, then here we use a kind of interesting way of being able to jointly predict all the different 1,000 different types of edges through kind of a, we have an interesting way how to do things here with a tensor so that we can basically learn to predict these edges in a combined or in a joint way so that we learn also how what are the correlations between different side effects. So this is now the architecture. Here are the outputs. Here is the predictor, and then there are the encoders to the left that I showed on the previous slide. So how well does this work? Here are the examples. This is our approach with different depth, how far in the network we are propagating this in terms of the AUC score, precision area under the precision recall curve, and the average precision at 50. And these are methods that people have used previously. They are basically tensor factorization based methods or feature based methods. And we are here getting very healthy improvements, especially in kind of across different metrics. What I want you to take away from here is that you can basically take these things and apply them to quite complex prediction tasks with, let's say, here in this case, edge prediction with thousands of different edges, and you can kind of encode and learn how to do this information propagation to be able to do these predictions. And then the last thing I want to tell you is about how could you do drug repurposing using this stuff. Okay, so the idea here is the following. Predict which diseases a drug would treat. Okay, so basically given a drug, I want to predict which diseases the drug can treat. And the formulation will be again through networks, and it will be through the PPI network. So the idea is I have the protein-protein interaction network, and then for every disease and for every drug, I have a subgraph, basically a set of proteins that are associated with that drug or that are associated with that disease. And then what I will want to do is I will want to go and compute the embedding for drugs as well as, for diseases as well as drugs, so that then I can do some kind of nearest neighbor matching and try to say who's treating whom. Okay? And the idea again is that these protein interaction networks give me kind of a medium over which I can learn to propagate information, right? So the idea is that drug is likely to treat a disease if it's nearby in a pharmacological space, right? And the way we will now think of this is, we'll think of this as link prediction between different subgraphs, right? I'll have a subgraph associated with diseases, I'll have subgraphs associated with drugs, and I want to predict associations between them. And how this is going to work, it's a very bad projector. But the idea is there is a drug node, there is the protein-protein interaction network, and now the way I'll propagate information is this in these kinds of triangles, from the drug down to the protein interaction network, across the protein interaction network, and up to the drug, and I can do this a couple of times, right? And again, what I will want to learn is how to transform the information, how to aggregate it, and how to pass it back. So now these architectures will look like this. If I have a graph, this is a protein interaction networks, these are the drugs, these are the proteins associated with a given drug or with a given disease, then basically here is how the parameterized information propagation graph would look like, right? I start with a drug, pass it down to the protein interaction layer, and then I pass it across the protein links and then up to the drug again. And then again, what are the parameters? Are all these transformation and aggregation functions I can learn. Again, I will have many of these, so I'll create these mini batches and then learn over them. Yes? Yeah?
Is it like completely localized on the drug, or the dimension where the drug
This is not localized, right? This comes from some biological databases that biologists collect by doing experiments. Actually, it's my next slide, right? So again, I have a protein interaction network, and then what I have is basically associations between drugs and proteins. And I make no assumption whether this thing is localized in the graph. It turns out it's a bit localized, but it's not connected. So it's not a contiguous region. It's better than random nodes, but it's not a blob. Right? And then I have the medical indication. And what is information? So these are the data sets we use. Okay? So what's the cross-validation, how we do this? We do it in a disease-centric way. So basically, the idea is that what I want to do is I will take out a disease, do my modeling, I will put in a disease and say what drugs could treat that disease. There is around 5,000 FDA-approved drugs. The question is, along this ranking of drugs, which ones, what's the rank of those that treat the disease? Show you how well this works. Here is our method in terms of precision recall, area under that curve or the AUC curve. This is a problem that in computational biology has been looked at quite a lot. You can see that, let's say, in terms of precision recall, it's around 0.6, let's say 0.7. We are at 0.85. In terms of AUC, let's say the rest is at around 0.7. We are almost at 0.9. What is super cool, actually, is that you can also take and kind of aggregate additional biological knowledge you have about relationships of these proteins. So you can take, for example, proteins that belong to similar metabolic pathways, that belong to the same metabolic pathway, and use this as another input just to train more robust embeddings. You can also say, oh, I want to embed proteins that have similar molecular function closer together. So this is kind of adding side information to this. And this gets you from 0.88 to 0.93. So it gives you another 5% boost by basically taking some relevant biological information, but that has nothing to do with drugs and diseases directly. And to show you a real test for this stuff, so we are actually working with Stanford School of Medicine, where they have this list, super secret because it's unpublished, of diseases and drugs that treat them. Okay? And for example, right, the idea is that for this disease, they discover that this drug treats it. And I think the story here is that this drug is available in Japan, it's all approved, and now they want to bring it to US so that they can treat, I think this is some bacterial infection. So the question is, if I give you a disease and I rank the drugs, how high will I rank the epsilon drug? Right? And here are the ranks, right? So it's about 5,000 FDA-approved drugs that are out there, and we are able to rank them at around, you know, 14, 26, 54, 36, 10, 26, 11, 16, and so on, right? So among, let's say, top 20, 30, we give you the right repurposed drug, okay? So I think this is quite exciting. So to conclude, right, I think kind of the research in the last few years has shown that this representation learning paradigm can really be extended to graphs and that it works amazingly well. No feature engineering is necessary, allows you for this nice combination of attribute data plus network information, and you get state-of-the-art results on many different tasks. The other thing I think that is cool is that it really allows you to extend to different types of graphs, different types of relations, and different types of machine learning tasks, which I hope to show you both in terms of scale with the Pinterest example, as well as richness of how you can model, let's say, biological problems around drug discovery and so on. So with this, I think I'm a bit over time, so I'll just finish. Thank you.